இது வந்து ஒரு 100 பேர் வந்தோடனே ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணிடலாம் மேடம். கார் வந்த உடனே, ஏன்னா அவங்களுக்கு வந்து நைட்டு 12 மணி 1 மணி நினைக்கிறேன். அவருக்கு போகும் தூக்கம். ஆக்சுவலா சென்னைக்கார் தான் அவரு. அதெல்லாம் அதுதான்.
Hello, this is Gauri here.
Hello, sir. I'm Dr. R. Pichai, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Yes, so sir.
I have the permission to share my screen. Do I have the permission to share my screen?
Shyamal. Given, sir. After some introduction, so you can share your screen, sir.
Hello. Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar. We are so glad to see you all here. I wish today to be a very special and meaningful day for all of us. Our hearty welcome to respected principal, deans, HODs, associate HODs and distinguished guests, special invitees and attendees of the webinar on developing a community-driven IoT data marketplace for smart cities. Is there a role for blockchain? We are thankful to all the participants from the all over the country and from across the globe for the overwhelming responses. We have received total 688 registrations for this webinar across 25 states from India. Also, we have received registration from UK, Indonesia, and USA as well. I'm taking this opportunity to introduce our department to all of you. The Department of Computer Science and Engineering at B.V. Raju Institute of Technology was started in the year 1997. The department offers UG B.Tech programs with intake of 300 students and a PG2 degree M.Tech programs, Computer Science and Engineering and the Software Engineering degree. Department is accredited by both NBA and NAC. From this academic year 2020-2021, we are approved to conduct three specialized B.Tech courses, namely Data Sciences, Business System, and Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning. All these courses have been approved with an intake of 180 degrees. We have signed MOU with several industries and training partners as well. Also, we have signed MOU with universities from US, Canada, and UK for the research collaborations, student certification, and promoting integrated PG courses, etc. Our students are additionally encouraged to participate in multidisciplinary projects and special focus is given to assistive technology laboratory exercises. Some of the focus trainings which we have been offering for the placements are advanced programming techniques, Telangana Academy for Skills and Knowledge, campus recruitment training, PEGA certification courses, robotic process automation, NASCOM and CoCube trainings, online certifications with the NPTEL, edX and Coursera, national level hackathon, online and offline coding contests through the platform like Talentia, CodeVita Talentia, British English Certification, a special center for graduate study in abroad center to empower and bolster students to take up higher studies abroad. We strive diligently to improve the overall knowledge, technical skills, aptitudes, and moral conduct of our students. To cater to this requirement, we have designed and conducted residential workshops at Vishnu Educational Development and Innovation Center to meet the qualities and requirements of the millennial students. Among all the workshops, the following are exceptionally valued and highly appreciated by our students: career aspirants in science and technology, intellectual learning in engineering application, aspire for career excellence, self-management skills. Now I'm glad to introduce our resource person briefly. He has a great and versatile research experience in the domain of IoT. Dr. Gauri Shankar Ramachandran is a senior research associate at Viterbi School of Engineering, University of Southern California. He is currently associated with Autonomous Network Research Group and Center for Cyber Physical System and the Internet of Things. His research interests include data marketplace, distributed data and payment management system, edge computing and systems of Internet of Things and smart cities. And he primarily focuses on performance, trust and scalability. Dr. Gauri Shankar work has received the Best Paper Awards at IEEE BigMM, Mobiquitas, Africa Tech, and Wixa Compark references. In 2016, he received an honorary certificate of appreciation from the IEEE Communication Society and the second prize at LoRa Alliance Global IoT Challenge for developing a smart medical fridge in DR Congo to preserve blood and vaccine supplies. He received his PhD in computer science from IMEC Distrinet, KU Leuven, Belgium. He completed his MS in Intelligent Embedded Systems from Mälardalen University, Sweden. During his MS, he visited the Technical University of Eindhoven, the Netherlands as Erasmus Scholar. He completed his BTech in Electronics and Communication Engineering from Sastra University, India. Now, I'm glad to read his versatile research profile as well. His research interests are focused on Internet of Things in particular. He works on the design, implementation, and deployment of IoT applications. He has over 5 years of experience in the IoT WI. The strong expertise in runtime reconfiguration and management of IoT applications across all layers of the stack. He is also specialized in low-power wireless communication and has involved in the deployment of IoT applications and test beds using technological such as LoRa, IEEE 802, IEEE 802.15.4e and Wi-Fi. Lately, Gauri is exploring blockchain technology and its application in IoT. Dr. Gauri is also involved in US Intelligent Internet of Things Integrator Consortium, which brings together researchers from various disciplines and IoT communities, including the City of Los Angeles, area residents, and industries. USC Viterbi Center for Cyber Physical Systems and Internet of Things is building a campus-wide IoT testbed to test and validate radio technologies, computing platforms, sensors, and actuators. This IoT testbed provides an opportunity for the consortium members to experiment their application ideas in a realistic IoT setting. Dr. Gauri is one of the leading developers of this IoT testbed. We like to take your valuable insights in this webinar. I would like to request our resource person to start the session. It's my pleasure to extend a cheerful welcome to all. Thank you, one and all. Sir, we are all keen to hear your intellectual insights. Thank you for every one of your keen participation.
Great, fantastic. Thank you so much for the introduction, Dr. Lakshmi. And also, I would like to thank Dr. Pichai for coordinating this webinar. I'm really excited to, talk about some of our ongoing work here at USC. Before I get started, let me share my screen.
Yes, sir. I'm going to stop my screen. Please, you can proceed. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir, perfectly.
Okay, let's get started. So this work that I'm going to describe today is something that we have been working on for almost 3 years here at USC. So in particular, this is gonna be in the area of smart cities and how we are connecting the community members in an IoT application development activities. And we are also look at how we can actually involve or apply blockchain technology to some of these problems that one would encounter in such an IoT and smart city type of a setting. So this is gonna be the outline for my talk today. So I'll be starting by introducing a deployment that I was involved in DR Congo. And through this practical deployment, I'm going to sort of motivate the need for community-driven IoT application model. And then I'll move on to IoT and smart cities, where I motivate the need for developing IoT-centric cities and how that can benefit the community members as well as the city administration. Then I'll move on to the data marketplace project, which we have been working on here at USC for almost 3 years. And I'm gonna describe the platform that we have developed and also gonna briefly talk about the application that is currently being developed here in Los Angeles. And then I will move on to how we created a decentralized version of the data marketplace using the blockchain technology. So without further ado, let me get started by introducing the application deployment. So this was the work I did back in 2016 while I was doing my PhD in KU Leuven, Belgium. So this work was actually focusing on deploying IoT infrastructure in DR Congo. So in particular, we were focusing on village called Kikwit in DR Congo, where there was this blood transfusion clinic, which was responsible for collecting blood and maintain it for the entire neighborhood or the collection of villages and towns in the vicinity. So here they would collect the blood and vaccine supplies, and then they would store these supplies in these fridges that you can see on this diagram. So as you can see from this figure, that this particular yes.
Sir, please be louder enough.
Okay. Am I not audible? Okay, thank you. Let me see if I can, just give me a moment. Let me see if I can increase the sensitivity of my microphone so that you can hear me better. Is it better now?
Yeah, sir, better.
Okay, great. Thank you. So this village that we were, focusing on in this project, they had no water source, so they had to rely on this river that was in the vicinity. And they had very limited resources to sort of keep their, services functional or operational for the community. So here you can see the figure of, an image of blood extraction in one of the blood collection sites. So this is the context that we are working on. We were working on this village, and we were focusing on this blood transfusion and storage application scenario. So one of the major problems that we had to deal with, or we ran into in the course of this project, was these hospitals or clinics, they did not have wired electricity to keep their fridges fully functional. So what they would do is they would go and collect blood and vaccine supplies, and then they would store it on this fridge. The problem is there was no wired electricity in the village. Therefore, these supplies, would lose their effectiveness, meaning when the temperature increases above the recommended ranges, the supplies that are stored in these fridges, they would get spoiled. Therefore, it is extremely important that they maintain these supplies in the right temperature. And without wired electricity, it was very difficult for them to keep these fridges fully functional for all the time. In addition, they also did not have enough financial resources to keep their electricity generators operational, meaning that they can only operate these power generators for a short period of time. And when that happens, they are not able to power their the fridges that store the blood and vaccine supplies. So therefore, we had to come up with a solution that helps them to optimally, power their, fridges using electricity generators so that the fridges, stay in the right temperature for longer duration. So this is where we, looked at the existing fridges that they had in the clinic. So the fridges that they had looked like this. So it had a temperature display button on the top. And then you can see this white paper on the side of the fridge. The way they would maintain the temperature of these fridges is someone would go and take a reading every morning. This is manual. And then they would write down the reading on these white paper. And then based on this, they have to like...
Dr. Gowri, there is a small request. Little bit of audio. Audiences are expecting Dr. Gowri, sir. Thank you.
Is it still not audible?
I able to hear, but a couple of people couldn't be able to hear it, seems, sir.
Okay.
We request all the participants also, please take care of your side, the audio settings. It's our humble request. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I have full sensitivity on my side. Maybe I'll increase my voice to see if that helps. Okay, from now on, I'll be
thank
more
you,
louder.
Sir. Sorry for the disturbance.
No
yeah,
problem.
Now everyone is telling now it is audible.
Okay, I'm coming closer to my laptop.
Yeah, that is right. Yeah.
So my face is going to look too big on the screen. So my apologies for that. Because that's the only way for me to, increase the sensitivity. Okay, got it. I'm going to be louder from here on. So from, from this diagram, especially the figure on the right side, there is a fridge with a white paper on it. And what they would typically do is every morning, and every evening, they would manually collect the temperature and note down these readings on this paper. And then based on their, observed readings, they would decide when to turn on the electricity generator or when to move the vaccine and blood supplies from one fridge to another fridge. So this was very manual. And then sometimes they could not, do this in a reliable fashion. Therefore, they ended up losing some of the valuable supplies that they were storing on these fridges. So this is where we came into the picture. What we did is we introduced an IoT technology to resolve the problem. So in particular, we deployed this low power and long range IoT solution called LoRa, which is in fact popular in India as well. It is gaining traction in Indian market lately. So this LoRa technology, allows you to cover 1 kilometer or more single hop. This is more like your mobile phone. So, as long as you are within 1 kilometer range of a LoRa gateway, you are able to connect to the gateway and send your sensor data to it. So therefore, what we did is we integrated LoRa-based sensors, these white devices that you see on this on these images. So we deploy these sensors onto these fridges, and they are all LoRa powered. And then all these sensor devices, they had temperature probe attached to them. And this temperature probe was actually monitoring the temperature of these fridges in real time. And it was reporting the data to the LoRa gateway that was in the vicinity. So what we did is we deployed these LoRa gateway in the blood transfusion clinic itself. So this slide has some images of our deployment there. You can see that the blue LoRa gateway box is deployed in the building. And then on the rooftop, they are deploying these solar panel. And we also attached temperature sensors to some of the fridges that were storing blood and vaccine supplies. And now with this technology and with this deployment, we were able to connect multiple fridges that were in the vicinity to our LoRa gateway. And by doing this, we were able to monitor the temperature of multiple fridges in real time. And whenever the temperature increases above the recommended range, we were able to alert the hospital authorities or the transfusion clinic authorities to take some action to save the supplies. So here I have a demo that I'm going to be showing. So this is also in YouTube. So this is the...
In this video, I'll be demonstrating our LoRa mini fridge.
Do you hear the audio as well? when I play video. Can one of you please confirm?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Here's one of our IoT devices. It is comprised of two parts. For the temperature monitoring, we use VersaSense's award-winning low-power micro plug-and-play technology. And on top of this, we use Microchip's RN2483 LoRa module for communication. We've integrated this platform directly into our fridge here, and it is sending data over the LoRa network to our Multitech conduit gateway. We provide a cloud-based web backend, which can be accessed on your phone or computer, and allows you to keep track of the temperature of multiple fridges in your network. Inside the fridge, we have a high-accuracy temperature and humidity sensing element, and it also displays its temperature on the lid through an e-ink display. Whenever the temperature rises above the recommended ranges, you can also be alerted via SMS to ensure that the appropriate actions are taken to safeguard your blood or other medical supplies.
So as you can see from the demo that whenever the temperature increases above the recommended range, the app would automatically send an alert to the healthcare professionals there in the neighborhood. Using the data that came from the fridges, we were able to predict when the temperature would increase so that we can give them alert in advance. For example, we could tell them that, hey, 3 hours from now, the temperature would increase the above recommended range. Therefore, this should be the right time for you to, take an action, either turn on the electricity generator or move the supply to another fridge, which is in a better condition. So someone raised hand. So does that mean, should I answer question or is there a technical issue? Someone raised hand. Hello? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir, we are hearing. Please proceed.
Got it. Someone raised hand, so I don't know. Whether it was for a question. If it is for a question, I would prefer to take it in the end, if that's okay with you. Yeah, okay, thanks. Okay, let me continue. So again, this was a deployment that we carried out in a small village in DR Congo. Through this deployment, we learned that IoT can actually solve real world problems. But at the same time, we ran into several technical issues such as keeping the device operational for a longer duration or keeping the gateway functional for longer duration without any disturbances. And we relied on a local cellular provider to give us internet connectivity and then texting services for our application. But an interesting thing that we noticed during our deployment is the telecom service providers were actually powering off their cellular towers every night at around 12 a.m., like midnight. They were doing this because they wanted to save electricity, because again, this region is not powered by wired electricity. Therefore, even the cellular operators were not keeping their services active for 24 hours. So these kind of issues, prevented us from having a reliable deployment. So these are some of the lessons that we learned from applying IoT technology in such a setting. So with that, lessons learned, let's look at how we can take a similar type of technology to smart cities, how it can benefit smart cities. If you look at a city environment today, there's an increase, increasing real-time data for various applications. This would range from smart parking or air quality monitoring, even in the space of vehicular IoT. There is an increasing need for monitoring the environment in real time to help the community members and also to provide. Could you please mute if you're not.
Sir, I have applied mute all, so you also need to unmute, sir, now. Sorry. You may need to unmute, sir. That's
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. I think, can you hear me now? I think I'm not muted.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Great. Yeah. So there is an increasing demand for real-time data in these types of applications in smart cities. So this is where we were looking at the existing IoT deployment model, like the one I just described in DR Congo. We also looked at how we can actually bring such application deployment model to smart cities, but then we identified some of the challenges in bringing traditional IoT model to city environment. Some of the challenges are listed in this slide. The first challenge is each application is actually developed independently and deployed. For example, within a city, if there is one department that is responsible for, let's say, transport, let's say within a city administration, there is a transportation department, they would go and deploy sensor for traffic management or monitoring different intersections and so on. And then there is another department, let's say the electricity and utility department, they would go and deploy sensors in another region just to monitor how the lights are being used, for example, in one of the environment. And then there could be another department that could go and deploy sensors for monitoring air pollution and so on. So these are like three different departments within a city going and deploying their own infrastructure to handle a subset of concerns or one particular concern for their department alone. So this is not going to scale, meaning that each department has to spend a lot of money to deploy sensors in the city. And this is going to lead to different applications and different use cases, which may not be effectively used by all the authorities or all the stakeholders in a city setting. And the cloud vendors, what they would do is they would also approach the city, and then they would say that, hey, we are from Amazon Web Services, and we could actually help you deploy a smart city for you. Or Microsoft could go and approach the city saying that, hey, Microsoft can actually deploy IoT for your cities. The problem with cloud-based smart city deployment is the city basically have to hand over the key of the city to these service providers. So you're basically stuck with either Amazon Web Services or Microsoft to run your city, which is actually not optimal in the long run. So this also leads to vendor lock-in, because you're locked into this particular vendor. Therefore, when you want to bring in some new technology from other vendors, you won't be able to bring in those technologies, because one vendor's technology won't easily operate with other vendor's technology, leading to some interoperability issues. So if you take a traditional IoT model like the one I described a little while ago and deploy it in the city, these are the problems that you will run into, and this is not ideal, and this won't be effective for the cities to maintain in the long run. So therefore, we need to look at some alternative deployment model or solutions for smart cities. And this is where we looked at this intelligent IoT integrator model, which is called I3. This is nothing but a data marketplace for smart cities. So if you look at this slide, on the left side, you can see that there are a bunch of devices that connect to the application. So this is the application model that is currently followed in IoT 1.0 approach. For example, in DR Congo, what we did is we deployed a bunch of sensors just to monitor the temperature of the fridges. The LoRa gateway that we deployed in DR Congo was only deployed for monitoring temperature of the fridges. We did not use that gateway for other purposes. So that's the type of application deployment model that is quite prominent in traditional IoT 1.0 approach. That's the one you see on this slide on the left-hand side. On the right side, what we are presenting is a new way of creating IoT applications for smart cities, which is through this IoT data marketplace called I3. Which is something that we have developed here at USC. So with the I3 based IoT development model, the devices that are owned by the community members, they would connect to this I3 data marketplace, and the application developers can actually go and buy IoT data from this data marketplace. So using this model, there is a complete isolation between the application developers and the device owners. So let's say that you are living in a city, and then you own a temperature sensor in your home. Then what you could do is you could go and post this temperature sensor data to the marketplace. Then the application developers would go and buy the data from the marketplace to build an application. So to illustrate this point further, here is a concept that we coined in this space called a marketecture. So this is similar to, you go and buy a collection of vegetables from the market. There are many vendors selling different vegetables, and you buy the vegetables that you want, and then you bring those vegetables to your home. And then you use those vegetables to cook whatever recipe that you have in mind. So we are creating a similar model for IoT, where we have data providers providing bunch of data. And you as an application developer, you go and buy the data that you want for your application. And then you use that data in your application. So that's the application development model that we are exploring in the context of i3 Data Marketplace. The way we are currently tackling this data marketplace project is through a consortium called i3, which is comprised of multiple academic and industrial partners. So the goal of the i3 consortium is to bring together all these community members and to create a sort of a public and private partnership to create an IoT ecosystem for smart cities. So at present, in our i3 consortium, there are a number of, players. So you can see some of the players that are currently part of our i3 consortium here. So we have City of Los Angeles, and we have the county, and we have few universities as well. And we have companies such as Oracle, Amazon Web Services, and so on. So all these players are actually participate in this community-driven IoT marketplace model. So what we do is we frequently meet and we discuss about architectural issues and business issues in creating a data marketplace for smart cities. And through this consortium, we are able to create a marketplace that is going to be beneficial for the cities, in the near future. So that's our goal with the i3 data marketplace. Now let us look at the technical details of i3 and at what stage we are in at the moment. So this is the architecture or the sort of the high level architecture of i3. If you look at this diagram, there's an i3 platform that is in the middle, which is nothing but a middleware. And then there are a collection of IoT devices or edge devices. And these are devices that are producing sensor data, and these sensor data can be shared with the i3 platform, and the application developers are actually at the north side of the platform. And if somebody wants to build an IoT application, what they would do is they would go and look at the i3 platform, and if there are any interesting data that is relevant for their application, they would pay for that data and then get access to it right away. So this is a real-time IoT data marketplace in the sense that if the data providers already registered their data in the marketplace, then the application developers can actually go and buy the data to build application. And this application can be made available to end users. So I'll show an example application in the next couple of slides. And in addition, we also provide data analytics or data enhancement services in the marketplace architecture. So here, when the data is flowing through this i3 data marketplace, one can also perform some data analytics like prediction or clustering and those type of activities. So this is the sort of the high level architecture of i3 data marketplace. So we have an ongoing application development work here in Los Angeles. So this is actually a parking application for the whole Los Angeles city. So here you can see a real-time parking situation for the Los Angeles city. So I'm going to zoom into one of the neighborhoods. So here we have data for the downtown Los Angeles, which is the city center. And we also have data for Hollywood region in Los Angeles. And then we have data for Los Angeles International Airport. And we do have data for, you know, few beaches and few other neighborhoods in Los Angeles. So now let me zoom into one of the region here. For example, if I zoom into the downtown, which is the city center, I can actually look at the parking availability in real time. So here, for example, in this particular street in downtown Los Angeles, there are 33 parking meters available or parking spaces available in total. And out of those 33, 7 are currently occupied and 26 parking meters are free. So here, what we are currently doing is we are trying to like bring together parking data from multiple parking providers. So here we have parking data from downtown parking providers. And then here we collect parking data from Hollywood parking providers. And then here we have collect parking data from UCLA, which is another university in Los Angeles. And then we also collect parking data from Los Angeles International Airport. So for Los Angeles International Airport, one can actually see how many parking spots are available in their parking structure. So here there are 1,432 parking spaces available. And then out of those, 627 are occupied and there are more than 800 spots that are free currently for vehicles to park. So now using something like an I3 data marketplace, all these parking providers who are distributed across the city, they can actually provide the data to the I3 data marketplace platform. And then the city of Los Angeles can actually get the data and build a parking application for the entire community. So in this case, this is a parking application that is developed by the city of Los Angeles. This is the city administration of Los Angeles. So they have built this application to help the community. So this is a perfect example of a community-driven data marketplace wherein the community members, in this particular case, parking data providers or the parking lot owners, they are providing data to the I3 data marketplace. And now the city of LA is able to acquire that data from the marketplace and build an application for smart cities. So this is an ongoing work. So at this point in time, not all the data points are going via I3. This is still in early phases. But I just wanted to show this application to explain the real world benefits of I3 data marketplace. So that's the idea with the I3 data marketplace. Let me go back and continue the slides. So here, the key stakeholders in an I3 data marketplace or any data marketplace is there is an administrator in the middle who is actually deploying a data marketplace. This could be your city administration or this could be any private or public entity who are interested in deploying an infrastructure for the city. And then seller or data owners, they would be the one providing data to the data marketplace. And then the application developers would be the one buying data from the marketplace and build their application. So here I would like to just throw in another analogy. So if you are familiar with Amazon Marketplace or Flipkart like Marketplace, what you would do is you would go and search for the products that you're looking for. And then the marketplace would list the products. You would look at the prices and you would look at the quality and all that for that particular product. If you like one of the products there, you just click buy and then pay for that product. And then you will receive the product in a day or two in your doorstep. So similarly here, when you use IoT data marketplace, you would go to the data marketplace and then you would search for temperature sensor, humidity sensor, parking data sensor, air quality sensor, whatever data that you're looking for. And then if there are data providers who are available to give you that data, you would simply acquire the data and build the application. So that's the IoT data marketplace model that we are currently exploring. So this is the platform that we have developed. So this is the open source software that is currently out there. So if you're interested in trying out this data marketplace, you can actually do it today. So I'll provide the pointer to the open source software at the end. So this is how the marketplace looks like. So there is a front end, which allow wants to browse the data marketplace. Front end actually serves the users. which is connected with the backend, and then whenever the data gets registered by the seller, it gets stored on the database that is running on the server. And if the if a buyer comes to the marketplace to buy the data, he would get access to the data. I mean, he would get a password to access the data once he makes a payment. So the current version doesn't support real payment. So currently we have disabled the payment support so that people can actually experiment with the market without involving real real currency or real payment platform. So here we use MQTT as a data broker to connect the seller's device with the buyer's device. So this is our IT data marketplace at the high level. So some of the, we have two versions of the data marketplace. Both of these versions are currently available. The latest version is actually providing support for MAP, which I'll demonstrate in a couple of minutes. Some of the key features of the marketplace include the publish subscribe broker, which is actually at the heart of the IT data marketplace. Those who are not familiar with publish subscribe broker, this is one of the widely used message exchanging platform in the IoT domain. This allows the IoT devices to easily share their data with the application developers or the other parties who are interested in using the data. We use MQTT, which is one of the open source and lightweight publish subscribe broker that is out there in the public. The whole marketplace is built using Python, and we also provide the REST APIs to help the buyers and sellers interact with the marketplace. And then there is also MySQL database to maintain all the product information and so on. So this marketplace is truly centralized, meaning that everything is running in one centralized infrastructure that is maintained by the city or any organization that is actually running the marketplace broker. And some of the other key features include rating of data products. So let's say that if you are a buyer and you bought a data product, but then you're not satisfied with the quality of the product or the data quality is not great, then you can actually go and rate that particular data provider. And if you rate some provider very badly, then that also helps the marketplace administrators to look at the data providers and remove the ones who are providing data with insufficient quality or who are not honestly providing valuable data to the market. And we also
recommend
all participants
Dr. Abhijit, please mute yourself.
Okay, great, thank you. We also provide we also provide support for identity and access management, and this module is responsible for providing access to the buyers who are interested in buying data from the data marketplace. I'm going to demonstrate this through a video of the platform that we have currently built. So this video is available in YouTube, so I will share it after the presentation. So this is kind of a long video, so I'm gonna move straight to the demo.
First, we show how to create an account on the i3 marketplace.
So this is how the i3 marketplace looks like. So the first step is to create an account on the marketplace.
Let's begin by considering a seller.
And then once you create an account, now this is an account created by a data seller. And once he creates an account, he will log into the marketplace and he has to create a hub for his organization.
We now show how a seller would create a hub to maintain a set of related devices and data products.
So once you created a hub, you can actually create devices that are going to be producing data for your IoT data marketplace. So now to register your device, you will have to go to the register device page.
The seller can now register a particular device.
So now during the device registration, you need to provide the hub name and your device name.
They can choose between password-based authentication using an API key or public key cryptography-based authentication.
So here we are demonstrating how a password-based authentication can be provided for the device. So now you are registering a device. Now your device is registered on the data marketplace, and now you can actually start sending data or streaming data from your IoT device to the data marketplace. So you can see the temperature device already registered in the marketplace. Now you
can. The seller then creates a data product listing to provide a description and set the price and usage rights associated with data from that device.
So now you registered a device, and then you'll have to register the data product associated with the device. So I just registered a light sensor device. Now I'm actually creating a light sensor data product, for example. And once I register my data product, now this will be available in the marketplace for the buyer to actually buy the data and use it. And while you're registering, you will also have to provide the GPS coordinates associated with the device so that it can appear on the map. So when an application developer browses through the marketplace, they can look at the map and find out where the devices are located before buying data from that device. So now the device is registered on the marketplace. You can see it's already appearing. Now you can publish data using a publish subscribe script.
Would interact with the i3 marketplace.
Now the buyer is.
Once they create an account and log in.
Now the buyer is creating an account on the marketplace, just like seller's account creation. And then after the buyer created an account, he can log in and then look at the products. So here you can see. So here they can look at the list of products that are currently available on the data marketplace. In this case, there is a light sensor data product and there is a temperature sensor data product. And then there is each data product has some price associated with it.
Show map view and look at products on a map.
And you can also look at the product on the map. So here we are just using the development version. If you're deploying it in your city, then you can actually subscribe to the official Google Maps API to have the proper map. Now the product would also appear on the map if you use the map view.
Online marketplaces.
Now the buyer can actually buy the data product by choosing the quantity. So he's choosing 10 data products, and then he's actually checking out just like you check out on a normal marketplace. Now you can, once you check out, you will receive password to access the data from the marketplace. And then a Python-based, publish subscribe script to receive the data from the data marketplace. So this is the demonstration of our i3 data marketplace. So this platform is currently available as the open source software. So you can actually, download the code and try it on your machine, today. So this was released about 6 months ago. So that's the demonstration of the i3 data marketplace. Now let's move on to the blockchain aspect. Is there a role for blockchain in such a data marketplace or such a community-driven data marketplace? Before we go into the issues around the marketplace itself, let's look at the benefits of having blockchain in any application.
The reason for buying and reserving, you get a pretty significant discount.
Can you please mute again?
If you pay 2,000 rupees for buying a server and an on-demand.
Okay. Dear participants, please be mute yourself.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate that. Got it. So now, for those who are not familiar with blockchain, blockchain started, around 2008, 2009 with the arrival of this Bitcoin paper by the anonymous author, Satoshi. And this paper sort of introduced, clever mechanisms to create a decentralized infrastructure for handling payments. So this was like a digital payment platform without relying on any centralized authorities. The key to the Bitcoin platform was its clever use of the proof of work algorithm to prevent Sybil attacks in the network. And this became quite popular. And after the Bitcoin's traction, many other platforms came into the market, such as Ethereum, IOTA, EOS, and so on. And all these platforms, provided some intelligent solutions to address issues around trust, security, privacy, and so on. So we are going to look at some of the key features of the blockchain platform here. And we are going to start with the decentralization feature that the blockchain platform provides. If you use a centralized infrastructure, that is what modern day banks does. So you're relying on the services provided by the bank. Therefore, you sort of trust the service provider in this case. You trust the bank to honestly maintain your finance and also the information or your transaction details private within the bank's infrastructure. So that's the assumption that we are making when we are using decentralized infrastructure today. But then if you look at some real world applications, they are inherently involving multiple organizations. So therefore, you need to look at infrastructure or solutions that can operate in a decentralized setting. So blockchain is actually providing tools to create decentralized applications involving multiple organizations or multiple stakeholders. So the figure on the left here shows the centralized application where all the clients would actually connect to the central controller, which is handling all your transactions on all the information. That's what today's bank does. The architecture followed by centralized systems look like that. And blockchain provides way to decentralize operations when your application involves multiple organizations. So here, there are three organizations that are part of this infrastructure or part of this application. And you can actually use blockchain technology to decentralize the operations. Now there is not a single controller that is managing your application. Now there are three organizations that are looking at all the transactions that are part of your application, and then they are the one making decisions or accepting transactions for you. So through this model, all these organizations have visibility, and this provides better transparency, and you can also go and handle disputes if there are any issues that you run into during your application lifetime. The next benefit of using blockchain technology is its immutable ledger. Blockchain uses a special type of data store to maintain all the transactions. Traditional databases that you would use in centralized applications today, they can be modified, meaning that if one entry is written to the database, that organization that is running that infrastructure can actually go and modify that database without your knowledge. If you have put some transactions onto that database, then that centralized organization can change that information at any time without your knowledge. Whereas if you use something like blockchain, it provides a write-only tamper-proof ledger, which means that you as an application user, you can write transaction to this blockchain, but once the transaction is written to the blockchain, it cannot be modified. Or if you try to modify the transaction, the blockchain won't accept it because it won't, the modified version won't be matching with the distributed storage that is currently on the blockchain. So therefore, this provides stronger guarantees when you're building distributed applications. And remember, this ledger is actually a distributed copy, and it is running on all the nodes. So here, for example, in this diagram, if you use a centralized application model, then the database is actually running on a single computer. You can actually modify the database without the client's knowledge. Whereas if you use a decentralized infrastructure like the one that we have in blockchain, then the ledger is actually copied to all the organization's infrastructure. Therefore, if you make a copy in your own local database, do some transactions based on the modified copy, it won't be accepted by the blockchain, because when other blockchain tries to verify the transaction, it will see a mismatch, because all the ledgers should have the same copy of the transaction details. If one ledger tries to modify the copy, it will no longer be valid, or it will no longer be accepted by the other nodes that are part of the blockchain infrastructure. So that's another benefit that blockchain provides. And third is the payment support. So most of the blockchain platforms that you encounter today, they already provide built-in support for payments. So if you're building applications that require support for payments, then you can easily use the payment capability offered by the blockchain platform. So that's another advantage of using blockchain. The next is the smart contract capability, which is one of the most promising capability that blockchain provides to the application developers. Some applications may require doing some processing, but then this processing has to be handled in a transparent and decentralized fashion. So smart contract gives you the ability in the blockchain. So if you use a central controller, you would write all the processing script and then you would just deploy it on the central controller, and that controller will run the processing for you. But then you don't have any visibility, you don't have any transparency. You will have to simply trust that central controller. Whereas if you use a smart contract, it actually executes this special processing scripts on the blockchain itself. Therefore, it provides more transparency. So using smart contract, you can actually set, or you could actually automate some business processes. And the business processes could be, for example, when an event is received from a client in the application network, notify the other clients and also transfer payment to one of the clients. For example, you can actually write these kinds of conditions or these kinds of business processes in the blockchain using smart contract. And then when a transaction reaches that smart contract, it will automatically execute all these the rules that you have written down on the smart contract. So that's the benefit of running smart contract on the blockchain. So it not only automates the business processes, but also it also helps you to have this transparency while executing some of these business operations on the blockchain. So these are the key features of the blockchain platform, and let's see how these features can be actually applied to the smart city context. So one of the projects that we did in this space is called Streaming Data Payment Protocol, which is actually a version of a data marketplace based on the blockchain platform that we developed at USC. So if you look at the i3 marketplace that I presented a little while ago, it was a centralized marketplace where everything was actually happening through the centralized middleware. So if you if you are a seller, you will have to rely on the centralized middleware, and then if you are a buyer, you will also have to connect to this centralized marketplace operator or the marketplace front end to do all the transactions. So you're relying on this intermediary. So here what we did with Streaming Data Payment Protocol is to build a peer-to-peer data marketplace that does not involve any centralized intermediary. So here we are actually using blockchain platform as a centralized intermediary. So the diagram here shows that there is a buyer and then there is a seller, and then let's assume that the seller has a bunch of data that he is interested in sharing with the buyer. So there are three channels that are part of the Streaming Data Payment Protocol. So there is a channel for payment, there is a channel for data, and then there is a channel for records. Okay, so through the data channel, the seller would share the list of data products that he has with the buyer. And then if the buyer is interested in buying the data, what he would do is he would notify the seller that, hey, I'm interested in buying this data. When he notifies the seller, he will also record that transaction in this immutable ledger that is provided by the blockchain. Now you may question why we need to record the transaction in the immutable ledger. So when you use a centralized infrastructure, you know, if there is a dispute, you can actually go and talk to this centralized service provider. So if there is a dispute in any of your bank transactions, what you would do is you go and talk to the bank to find out what actually happened with your transaction. Now, in this protocol, there is no intermediary. Everything is peer-to-peer. It's the interactions are happening without any centralized authority or any centralized controller. Therefore, without any record, it's hard for one party to prove that, hey, I actually performed this action correctly. But then you need to show the proof. So therefore, there should be some sort of proof to handle disputes if there is a dispute after certain transactions. So therefore, what we do is all the exchanges between seller and the buyer must be recorded on this immutable ledger offered by the blockchain. And then when there is a dispute happens between seller and the buyer, we can actually go and look at the record on the blockchain to resolve the disputes. And then we have a payment channel that is going to allow the buyer to make payment to the seller. So this protocol is completely peer-to-peer. We rely on the blockchain's immutable ledger and cryptocurrency capability to deal with payment and as well as recording. And then the data layer is simply a TCP connection with some security enhancements. So we have built this protocol using IOTA, which is one of the blockchain distributed ledger platform. And the code is currently available as open source software in this GitHub link. So if you're interested, you can actually download the code and play with the protocol. And this was in fact presented at a workshop about 2 years ago. So this is one of the protocol, and this protocol leverages the blockchain's cryptocurrency platform. And the records layer is also leveraging the immutable ledger capability of the blockchain for storing the records of transactions. So this is one of the protocol that is allowing a version of the marketplace that can operate without any centralized authority. And we also developed another version of the marketplace to overcome the limitations of centralized marketplace. The i3 marketplace that I presented earlier is centralized, and it relies on this centralized intermediary. So all the operations actually depend on the centralized service providers. But the problem with the centralized provider is they can manipulate the ratings of a seller or the buyer, or they could hide some data products from being visible to the buyers. For example, they may be biased or they may be malicious. So therefore, we want to have a transparent data marketplace where all the operations are visible to all the sellers and the buyers. And centralized models are typically vulnerable to these central point of failure issues, because if this centralized party is compromised, then all the activities that are handled by that particular intermediary is not going to be reliable or trustworthy. Therefore, you need an alternative architecture wherein you can have high level of transparency and visibility. So this is where we built a marketplace using blockchain, which is called a Decentralized Data Marketplace, or DDM. And this was a paper we published about 2 years ago. So using this, in this decentralized data marketplace, all the marketplace functionalities are actually implemented in the blockchain. Some of the functionalities include, data transfer and payments, storing the information about the seller and the buyers. And then we may also need to store information about the ratings of the seller and the buyer, and so on. So all these information, all these functionalities, we have implemented in the form of a blockchain smart contract, like you see in this figure. So here, there is a seller who has some data that he wants to sell. He can actually post the product information to this smart contract that we deployed on the blockchain. And then if there is a buyer who is interested in buying the data, he can actually go and query the smart contract to look at the list of data products. And then if he decides to buy the data product, then he can actually use our STPP protocol that I presented in the last slide to actually buy the data. So the way we built this marketplace is using this Ethereum platform, which provides support for smart contracts. And we also use this IPFS, which is a distributed file storage platform to store data. So I'm going to show the demonstration of the decentralized data marketplace that we built. Again, the code is available in GitHub. So if you're interested in experimenting with this. So here we are first going and searching the marketplace, and we are seeing two data products, and then we are registering a new data product. So here we are entering the data product information. So here we are registering a gas sensor that is providing CO2 data, and we are entering the latitude and longitude, and we are providing price information, and we are also entering the IP address at which this sensor is available, and then we are registering the data product. Now the information is actually stored on the blockchain. So now it's going to take about a few seconds for the transaction to appear on the blockchain. Now when we look at it immediately, you will see that the data product is not available. Now we have also shown the client software that is going to receive the data. Now we are searching, the new data product is not available. So if I just fast forward a little, here, there you go. Now you have the new data product that's available on the blockchain. Now you can check out, meaning that you can buy the data product. Now here using IOTA, so therefore when you're buying a product using IOTA, you're required to provide your seed. So here we are providing a simple seed to buy the data. And then we are, including the quantity, meaning the amount of data item that we want. Now we are waiting for the transaction to be confirmed on the IOTA blockchain. So this is going to take a few seconds. There you go. Now the transaction, it says the order is placed. Now the data transfer starts. So once the data transfer starts, you will see that the data gets downloaded to the browser in a few seconds. Let me fast forward a little. You can see that the transaction is being processed. Let me stop here. Now you can see that there was a file called gas.dst.txt that gets downloaded here. Yeah, there you go. So you see that there's a file that got downloaded after the payment is made. So this is the marketplace. So as soon as your payment is confirmed, the data provider would give you the data. Now he provided the data in the form of this TXT file. And then now you can see the invoice information and all that for that particular data product. And you can see now we just provided dummy data like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, just to demonstrate how this would work with the blockchain platform. But we have the software available as open source. We used Ethereum smart contract and also IOTA as a payment platform. So one can actually download and play with this platform. So the blockchain capability that was leveraged by DDM is actually the cryptocurrency facility that blockchain offers. And we also use the immutable ledger for storing the records. And we use smart contracts for managing the product and the ratings of the users. And then we use a decentralized storage to store some information about the products and other metadata that is needed for the blockchain. So that was a decentralized version of the marketplace that we built using the blockchain technology. So now as you can see that the blockchain technology offers some benefits to applications that are in the field of IoT and smart cities. So with that, I would like to conclude with a short summary. As you can see that the data marketplace provides a scalable application development model for smart cities. By involving the community members, one can actually build applications much faster and also at large scale. And we provide an open source software which can be used by the other community members and cities. This is currently available. People can actually download it and use it. And again, the city scale parking application is actually showing the benefit of such a data marketplace and how other cities can actually get inspiration from this application and explore or experiment with this data marketplace concept. And there are some interesting problems around security, privacy, and data analytics in this context. And we have shown how a decentralized version of the marketplace that is more transparent and more decentralized is can be created using the blockchain technology. But there are a number of other problems in this space. So I've listed some of the papers that are describing the open problems and also some issues that we have already addressed in the past 2 or 3 years in the slide. So for those who are interested in receiving the slide, please send me an email to the address that I have given here, or I'll be sharing the slides with the organizers of the webinar. Please reach out to them to get access to the slides. And these are the open source software that is currently available. One can actually download it and try it out if they are interested in experimenting with some of the software that we have created at USC. So that concludes my presentation. So I'd be happy to take some questions now. Okay, so how do we do the Q&A? Should we ask the attendees to directly unmute and ask the questions? Hello? Yeah, you can unmute and start asking questions because I see
Sir, there are 3 questions have come already, sir. Because of lot of text messages, I have copied and I am retaining with me. So, shall I proceed in reading the question, sir?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, thank you, sir. How can we authenticate the data which we will get from data providers? Can we get data for free from any sources? Can you please list any registered authorities for authentication, data authentication regarding their asking on the whole, sir? How can we authenticate the data which you will get from data providers? Can we get data for free from any sources?
Oh, great question. Yeah. Yeah, let me answer the question. So the i3 marketplace itself provides an authentication mechanism to let the buyer receive the data. But I think your question is more related to the data quality. How can one assess the quality of the data that is coming via the marketplace? That is still an open problem, so that's an excellent question. We are currently looking at addressing this open problem, because how do you know that the temperature is actually 27.5 degrees Celsius in the neighborhood, not 28.5? I mean, there's no way to verify that. So we are looking at ways to verify this mechanism, but this is an excellent question. We are currently addressing it using data analytics and other methods. And with regards to free data, it's up to the data provider. They can provide the data for free, or they can set some purpose for the data. So again, we leave that to the data provider.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. There are 2 more questions. Please tell something about how blockchain is working in stock market and chart applications.
Sorry, I'm not very well versed in that domain. So therefore, I won't be able to provide a useful answer. Maybe centralized stock markets might be susceptible to a control point of failure. Maybe it would be good if you mute all participants. I see a lot of background noise. A useful answer, but I believe one can actually create a decentralized version of a stock market using blockchain technology. But I'm not sure whether you want to create a decentralized version of chat, and what is the benefit in doing that? And blockchain is going to be too slow for real time message exchanging, and chat is going to involve a lot of data. So I don't know where you would store the data. Therefore, it's important to look at the motivation for creating a decentralized version of the chat, because blockchain is not going to be efficient for such an application. Next question, please.
Yeah, we encourage our audiences to come out with questions if you have. before the valedictory session. So for now, whatever the questions have come, we have harvested.
Thank you. Yeah, I would encourage the participants to unmute their microphone and ask questions directly. I saw a few people raised their hands during the talk. So please unmute your microphone and directly ask your questions. I see some information in chat. Are there any questions in chat window?
No, sir. Everything over. I have collected whatever the questions have come. Now they are in the Thanksgiving process, sir. They are expressing their gratitude and feedback formality. These are all only going, sir.
Okay. So, I mean, for those who are not interested interested in asking questions right away, I would encourage you to note down my email address and feel free to reach out to me with any questions. I'd be happy to answer your questions, or if you want to, more about any particular aspects of any of these projects, I can actually share relevant pointers and papers with you. So please feel free to reach out.
Blockchain in education.
I have also listed some of the web pages that would be helpful for the attendees. So these are all the web pages that could be beneficial for you. CCA web page is actually the one that provides a high-level overview of the center that I work at. And then I3 website is the one that is helpful for people interested in joining the I3 consortium. And if you want to learn more about the consortium, you can look at i3.usc.edu. And blockchain.usc.edu is the webpage where we maintain all the blockchain projects and all the events that happen in the blockchain space at USC. And then anrg.usc.edu is actually another research group that is at here at USC, where I'm working as a senior research associate. So please feel free to check those links as well. And I would highly encourage you to reach out to me by email if you have any additional questions, or if you want to discuss any issues in this space.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, I want to do a research in the blockchain. So I was thinking about taking the blockchain education. So can you tell me how I have to go about it?
Yeah, so the blockchain space is kind of huge. So it is very important to, have a clear goal. But no matter which research topic that you choose, you will have to have a basic understanding of Bitcoin, proof of work, Ethereum, blockchain platform, because Ethereum is the strongest candidate for smart contracts. So therefore, I would encourage you to take up courses that introduce the fundamentals of blockchain, such as Bitcoin, and also do courses on smart contracts, because such courses would help you, gain expertise in smart contract development and Ethereum blockchain platform. Because in the blockchain space, when you do research, especially when you address issues such as security, trust, and transparency, privacy, those kind of problems, it is very important to understand what kind of capabilities that blockchain provides. I mean, if I say smart contract is good for automating business processes, yes, it is good at high level, but one has to pay a lot of attention to how the software is written and how well the code is protecting the privacy of the individuals and how well the smart contract is written. These details you will only understand if you have a good understanding of how the smart contract platforms are running on the blockchain itself. So therefore, yes, before you do any research, it is very important that you cover these Bitcoin platform and the Ethereum platform and smart contracts and so on. Then you can move on to researching blockchain. But again, please have a clear goal on what exactly you want to address in the blockchain space, because it is very huge and a lot of problems have been addressed in the recent past. Therefore, it is very important to, you know, carefully look at the existing literature before you decide on the problem.
Yes, sir.
You know, feel free to reach out to me. Feel free to reach out to me. I'd be happy to provide more inputs if you have more specific questions, because you asked a very high level question. Maybe if you just go one level deep and ask a specific question that, hey, this is the background and I have, and this is the area that I'm interested in, then we can have a more meaningful discussion.
Yeah, sure, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. There is no more questions as of now. Shall we proceed with the valedictory address, sir?
Yeah, if there are no other questions. Yes,
no please. Other questions, sir. Thank you, sir.
Please proceed.
Great. Thank you, everyone. We appreciate you being here. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for our resource person, Dr. Gauri Shankar Ramachandran, for sharing wonderful research insights on developing a community-driven IoT data marketplace for smart cities. Is there a role for blockchain? We are fortunate to have interaction with Dr. Gauri, who has a real-time research experience that too in the Industry 4.0 technologies. Thank you, sir. I acknowledge the contribution of those who worked behind the screen for the successful conduction of this webinar. A special mention to our visionary management, respected principal Dr. Lakshmi Prasad Garu and HOD Dr. C.H. Madhubabu Garu, who is a catalyst who simulated us to do our best and standing as pillars of strength. With a deep sense of appreciation, we thank our organizer of this webinar, Dr. Pichai and Mr. Maravarman of today's session, and Dr. Purnachan and Mr. Shyamal Rao for their technical support. Thank you, sir, for sacrificing your late evenings and being with us for sharing your research insight. Dr. Gauri, really, 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 thank you from our bottom of our heart. Thank you, one and all. Wish you all success. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, great. Let me also say a few words. Thanks a lot for having me today. And I would like to thank Dr. Pichai for his effort in organizing this webinar. I hope I've shared some valuable insights to all the participants. And like I said, please feel free to reach out to me. I'd be happy to provide more details or share these slides. If you're interested in exploring any of these projects, or if you want to work on projects in these spaces, I'd be happy to provide provide my inputs in any way possible. Hope to hear from some of you after this webinar. So please stay safe in these tough times. I wish you all the best for your future endeavors. Thank you very much.
Hello, sir. I'm Pichai, sir. Very, very thank you, sir. Immediately you accepted our request, and even this is night time for you.
You
sacrificing your sleep.
Perfectly fine time.
yes, sir. Very, very thank you, sir.
No problem at all. Yeah, I mean, it was a pleasure participating in this webinar. I was glad see this many participants in the webinar. So thank you for organizing. Thank you for your effort.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Thank you all. Bye bye.
Thank you all. Wish you all success. See you soon in forthcoming sessions.
Ramaswamy sir. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I will give it to him.
Hello, sir. Amjan, sir.
Sir, hearty congratulations. Wonderful job, sir.
Thank you, sir. Without your support, we can't.
Lakshmi madam also wonderful anchoring.
Lakshmi madam did a very, very, very good job, sir. Last 1 month.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, Pichai sir, hearty congratulations.
Sir, thank you, sir.
Brother relationship, that bond, even he is having that bond.
Okay, sir.
madam. He's also very, very happy.
Yes, sir. Thank you all, sir.
Transportation, second point, and third one.